This is Ham Radio Now, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. What the heck? In the entire world. Yes. Hamfest Fun Redux. I think I'm both using that correctly and pronouncing it correctly, but I need to check. Redux. Brought back. Revived. And the reason I have to be, I suppose if it was, you know, French, it would be Redu. I think it's French. I think. Let's see. It's going to pronounce it for me. If I push this button and turn that up.
Redux.
Redux. Yeah, it was close enough.
Redux.
Okay. Well, thank you. The reason why this is Redux is because I've already done a show called Hamfest Fun. And, yeah, there it is. Way back in those thrilling days of this time, it is yesteryear, not yesterweek. April 26th, 2012, episode 9, and in fact, episode 9A. So, that's a long time ago. Same Hamfest. It's these guys, the Raleigh Amateur Radio Society. That's my local club. I was their president back in the late 90s. My lovely wife, Cindy, was their president for a term before me, and she was the Hamfest chairman for this Hamfest for close to 10 years. So I don't plan on going April 15th, because that's over. It's 2017. I'll update the website sometime before the next Hamfest. My cursor keeps disappearing on me. So this is actually going to be three segments within this program. When I went to the Hamfest, I took my camera. I wasn't sure what I was going to get, if I was going to really find anything useful at all. I knew that that John Breyer was going to be doing the satellite contact. John is the space comms guy. And you've already seen that, and you know that that he did it, and it was very good. It was very successful, but I didn't know that going in. I was just kind of crossing my fingers. I didn't know what else I was going to get. Turns out I did three other interviews, and I think that they're pretty interesting, certainly worth putting on, worth your attention. They're about hams doing ham stuff, so Jeff would be pretty excited, except most of the time we hear them talking about doing ham stuff and not not doing the ham stuff. But at least they're talking about it. And it occurs to me that I should explain that I don't think this is something I intend for every one of you to do. You know, sometimes I think if we put a program on showing hams doing ham stuff, the idea is we want to talk you into doing it. And that's not the case. It's not the case now, and it's generally not the case with any of the programs that I put on. The idea is, here are some interesting things about ham radio that you might enjoy learning about. Add to your collection of knowledge. Maybe someday you'd be interested. Maybe a few of you would be interested right away. Maybe most of you never at all, but it's kind of interesting to see other people do them or talk about them. So that's what this is all about. These are three short-ish segments. The longest one will come first. It's about 16 minutes. The other two are under 10 minutes. I could have done them as three separate programs, but that's not the way we roll. Here at Ham Radio Now, we do longer shows. Let's see. I have extensive notes here, and everything is up to date except for Arvin. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Arvin's sitting back there. He's our representative, our chief financial officer. Stop by hamradionow.tv. Find his icon at the bottom of every page. Click on that. Take you to the contribution page, and you can send us some money. This Hamfest was not expensive to cover. It was a couple miles away. I was going to be going anyway. But heading for Dayton, and, you know, like the other guys are whining about how much is... Okay, they're not whining. If they're whining, then I'm whining about how expensive it is to go there and cover this stuff. When the truth is, we would all go anyway. But this way I get you to pay for it. HamRadioNow.tv. All right, part one, I'm going to do this as much as I can, like This American Life, if you're familiar with that program. Part one. Packet is back. Or did it ever go away?
Hi, I'm Tad, KA2DEW, and I am working on creating a ham radio thing that is not so much of a club, but what we're trying to do is actually build an off-the-grid text messaging network on amateur radio, entirely divorced of commercial equipment requirements, no internet. We're not necessarily avoiding tower sites, but we're kind of focusing on sites that hams can get their hands on in the case of an emergency.
It sounds to me like you've given this pitch before.
Maybe.
Like about 50 or 60 times so far today.
Today, yeah.
It is VHF packet.
So, yeah, what we're doing is we're using pretty much old school packet radio technology.
Because VHF packet died in the late 90s.
It did. And
this is not 2017.
This is 2017.
What's the deal?
Oh, my God. Oh, yes. Anyway, the future, it's here. So several deals are interesting. One of them is that the TNC that was made before as a dedicated piece of hardware that the Tucson Amateur Packet Radio Organization came up with was amazing for its time. And it was reproduced ad infinitum and is still being sold for $200 commercially. But it's very old school. Nowadays, we can take a device that looks a little bit like this. This is a Raspberry Pi, which is an outrageous computer for $35, made by the Raspberry Pi Consortium, or I got that wrong. But anyway, what we're doing is we're taking the Raspberry Pi and a little $40 device that W2FS is making for Coastal Chipworks, and that is that plus a Raspberry Pi makes a TNC. It's just as it's actually pretty much applicable.
The biggest thing there is the battery.
Yes, I'll explain that in a second. So the Raspberry Pi is a very powerful computer. This little header was made originally as a daughter card for the Raspberry Pi to turn this into a TNC. The total price of this is on the order of $80. And you could imagine that a Raspberry Pi is quite a bit better of a computer than a Z80 or a 6801, which is what the $200 TNCs have. Now what we can do with this is use it as the kernel of our network. And what we're making, hopefully, is something that's a lot faster and a lot more interesting to play with for the ham who wants to play with it. We're making a very visible and all-inclusive packet radio network. It's old school, but in other ways, it's extremely educational and fun to play with.
The people that are watching this, a few of them experienced packet.
Yes.
Back in the 80s and 90s.
Yes.
Most of them have no idea what we're talking about.
Okay. So what this does is it allows you to take stations and connect them together digitally in such a way that you can pull out a cell phone and send a text message to one of the other participants. And the text message entirely propagates through amateur radio to the other stations down the line.
How do you get from the cell phone to a ham radio?
It is, yes. You can use a cell phone or a laptop or a tablet.
How do you get from the cell phone to the ham radio?
We're using Wi-Fi to go across our houses, or Ethernet if you're using a laptop or a desktop PC.
Okay, so not into the cell network.
Not into the cell network.
Wi-Fi. And you got, is something here Wi-Fi?
Yeah, we have a little Wi-Fi station sitting on top of that node over there.
So this little box here doesn't have any Wi-Fi.
This doesn't have
that.
Actually, the Raspberry Pi has the Wi-Fi built in now. So okay. If you have the latest model Raspberry Pi, which is still $35.
Okay, so you're using your phone as
a terminal. Right.
Text terminal.
Exactly.
It's not fast enough for video or pictures or anything.
Our packet network is not fast enough, no. So we're running about 44 characters per second between stations on our network. And that allows for several stations to have a conversation over it at a time. Now,
this is the 2 meter, 1200 bits per second, the old packet.
We're running it on multiple bands. But yes, this TNC is old school. Now, one of the things that's neat about getting together 50 or so people to work on a project like this is that every one of them brings something different to the table. Obviously, when you look at these boxes, we have carpenters in our midst. We also have radio service folk. These radios down here, these are commercial two-way radios, which are cast-offs from various enterprises. This is a 45-watt two-meter radio, which compares very well with the $150 new ICOM, excepting that the front panel isn't very versatile. But it's excellent for packet. And on eBay, you can buy these without accessories for really, really cheap. But we don't need the accessories. We don't need microphones.
So you're trying to build a totally shoestring network.
Yeah. So one of the things that's kind of neat is some of the people who come to the table to help us build this have expertises in areas that can they can bring the prices way down. So instead of using the equipment that's exactly what's out there off the shelf for hams, we're using things that are homemade. We have new circuit boards that we're making, like this one right here. This is a new circuit board that W4RFQ made. And what this does is a power supply for a Raspberry Pi that supports charging a battery and automatically switching over to the battery when the main power fails. And it has a dialogue with the Raspberry Pi to tell it to turn off before the battery dies. So this is our universal, it's a backup system. It's a UPS that's exactly what the hams need. This isn't exactly applicable for the average Raspberry Pi user because it runs off 12 volts or 13.8.
Let me try to.
Yeah.
Patch things together for a moment here.
Yeah,
so we're talking about doing is using a phone to generate some text, send it on Wi-Fi over to your ham radio.
To your ham radio, yep.
Enter the packet system going from your house to where?
To another guy's house.
And
then from his house to the next, to the next, to
so
the next.
So a few hops, and then it shows up at somebody else's phone.
Right now, our network is 8 hops wide, and we can send a message the length of it and back in 20 seconds.
So this is a very local thing.
It could be statewide, but it will start getting aggravating at that point. But basically, one of the neat things about this and the architecture we have is very visible. Anybody can get on it and play around, see what, oh, I want to go over to this guy's station and see what links he has. What links does he want to have? How well do they work? All of this is visible. So not only can you figure out what your own systems are doing and what your neighbors are doing, but you can actually navigate the whole network and explore. Mostly what we do on the network is have roundtable chat, sort of like internet relay chat, but entirely on ham radio, and it's kind of a kick. So if you visit our website, you'll find basically a list on the first page of the kind of things that we learn by playing with our network.
Is there a overall goal for this? Is it MCON? Is it something else? Or is it just to play?
MCON, well, certainly to learn and to play is top on the list. But one of the neat things is once we get one of our stations built, so this is a 3-port packet node based on surplus and off-the-shelf and homebrew combination and carpeted by N6LUZ. Thank you very much, Skip, for the boxes. This is a semi-portable apparatus that if you had 3 or 4 of these things, we could tie hospitals together in separate counties in the times of emergency. So Time Warner and Verizon and AT&T are offline for whatever reason for a week or two. And the hospitals need to be able to pass a list of the patients that have been transferred from one hospital to another. We can send an Excel spreadsheet between the computers in this hospital and that hospital through a multi-hop network that could be 100 miles long using equipment that was only installed in the time of the emergency. And this is equipment that the people who are building our network know how to build, know how to maintain, and know how to set up the routing for. And the thing works fairly well.
Do you have some specific software that you use to generate your traffic, or can you use a variety of FL Digi or something?
Well, we can use software that was in use in the 90s, and a lot of that software is still being built and maintained. F6FBB bulletin board, G8BPQ routing software, and we do. We also have some homebrew software. NC4FG wrote a web app that runs on the Raspberry Pi, and we can bring up a web page on any of our devices and see the data that's coming in and out of our stations. It's actually kind of neat, very non-1990s.
Do you make any connections to the internet to get in and out and from one place to another?
We do internet connections for configuration and upgrades. We do not use internet at all for our traffic.
How scalable is this in terms of territory you could cover?
Each of our radio hops is around 10 to 15 miles here in the flat forest. Living here on the Piedmont, we don't have natural mountains, and the artificial mountains are really hard to get into. Tall, thin mountains. So there is a scalability issue when it comes to real-time access station to station. We might be able to have a keyboard conversation from one end of North Carolina to the other, but it's very unlikely that we would have a live keyboard conversation to Boston, even if there were hundreds and hundreds of stations building a network that actually went that far. Eventually, we'll fall back to store and forward bulletin boards and so on.
So I was going to ask about bulletin boards. Bulletin boards are not part of the system at this point.
A bulletin board is actually built into every one of the stations. We could turn on and leave messages at each other's houses. We can set up forwarding and all the old school stuff if we wanted to. So far, we're not big enough to make that really more than fun. So we can fiddle around with it. But we're not big enough
yet. So maybe your idea for expansion is not necessarily to expand your network, but to say, hey, you want to do this, you can do this in your town.
Exactly.
And build one of these
exactly.
things. They may never be connected to each other.
On the website, we have a shopping list, and we have instructions. But let me tell you, if you want to build a multi-station packet node, and you're a long way from here, call one of us. Get on the webpage and look us up, because we'll be enthusiastic. And maybe we can spread some of that enthusiasm. But if it does turn out that you're only 100 miles away from the nearest network connection that already exists, 100 miles is doable. It would be very interesting to find the five or six people to go in between. If you are in a place with mountains, simplex VHF range is a lot further. When I lived in New England, we could 70, 80 miles on 440 was doable. Around here, the trees and low hills will stop that. Also, you have to know that we are very well aware that there is much, much faster amateur radio data comms than 1200 baud over VHF radios. We don't have that here, and it's actually going to be fairly difficult to get broadband over amateur frequencies, over Wi-Fi on ham radio, etc. That's going to actually be rather difficult here because of the hills and the trees and the flat forest.
You need the big buildings and towers.
But when it comes, we have a bunch of network enthusiasts who will love to play with it. We are not in competition with that, but we are doing something that's easier. It's much more simple to build something like this in your house.
So you might be talking about things like Arden and HamWAN.
Exactly.
Which
broadband
ham radio
people kind of
have seen. Yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I have a 4 foot wide 5.6 gigahertz dish in my backyard, which my wife is very happy about. we're just waiting for the day I can point it someplace.
All right. One of the things that I've noticed as you've given local demonstrations is that a lot of the folks that are working with you tend to be very young.
Is that true? Young?
Compared to me. Maybe even compared to you.
I don't think so. I think it may be that those are the ones I can con to go to the ham radio clubs to do the dog and pony show. In general,
but they do seem interested.
I think we do attract younger hams, which is actually a benefit.
What attracts them? What is it about this? Hold that microphone up close.
One of the things that you know is that people get into ham radio with an eye towards independence from the commercial networks. Because you can do a lot of the things that we do on ham radio, you can do on the internet. And a lot of people get into ham radio anyway. So they're already predisposed towards doing things that can be done on the internet better on ham radio. And so it does attract people to do those things. And it's kind of a neat thing. And I never would have really guessed that 5 years ago. I'm learning from this process. This is a great experience for me as well as everybody else that plays in our little group.
How long have you been doing it?
I've been doing Tarpon for 4 years. I was involved in packet radio in the 90s. In fact, I was one of the founders of the Northeast Digital Association that was in New York and New England and a little bit of Canada, Ontario, Quebec, and Nova Scotia. And that was a huge fun also. This is actually different from that. It's a diversion from that. It's also much more modern, believe it or not.
So your network started, I guess, 4 years ago.
Yes.
With two stations.
Well, actually, it took three, because the two guys who got together to talk about this, we weren't in simplex range.
So you needed a relay.
Yeah, so Tim actually brought his mom into the picture, and we used her garage in the backyard.
All right. I was going to ask how you pronounced it, so you said it
as Tarpon. Yes.
And terrestrial as opposed to space?
As opposed to using ionospheric or space communications, yes.
Okay. Makes sense.
So basically, we are putting together a full-time up network, whereas HF and satellite is a lot of fun, a heck of a lot of fun, but it is not terrestrial, it's not full-time up. So this is kind of what we're going for, is we're building stations that stay around and are always connected.
Yeah, and again, I'm getting the idea that this is just something fun to play with. It may or may not have a more useful purpose somewhere down the road.
Right, we will be lucky. We will be lucky, unlucky actually. If we actually need to deploy our stations, it's because something bad happened. But we will be prepared for that.
Yeah, it just becomes another tool.
It is, yes.
All right, thank you, Ted.
Thank you.
Okay, that's Todd's website, the Terrestrial Amateur Radio Packet Network. So maybe it's something that you do want to do. I don't know. But if it is, this is the place to go. Tarpon.org, T-A-R-P-N.org. You know what also occurs to me? These are not very good. Well, that one's not so bad as a radio show for the audio audience, because that was mostly just talking head stuff. You could see the stuff. You could see the equipment that he was talking about sitting on the table. You couldn't see it actually operate. This next one is going to be a little more visual, because I'm standing in the midst of things happening. So segment two, I am calling Smoke and Solder. And I don't think those guys have a patent on that term.
Should work great for you.
Coil it up there.
Congratulations.
Grab a microphone.
Uh-oh. Talk up close.
Okay.
It's noisy here. Who am I talking to?
My name is Justin. I'm a volunteer over here at the J-Pole table.
We have done this show before, I know.
We have.
But it is so impressive that... The other camera is over there.
Okay.
It's so impressive that I thought we would do it again. I'm putting a few things together for the Hamfest. What are you guys... Why is this so popular, and what are you doing, or
well,
vice versa?
Well, this is an opportunity for people to make things, which, you know, unfortunately, not a lot of people do this in our society anymore. A lot of the folks that you see here in line have probably just finished their ham test and are on their way to buy their first radio, or maybe just bought their first radio. So what we offer here is an accessory for their first radio to help them get out a stronger signal, help them enjoy the hobby more. These are roll-up J-poles. They can be used portably, or you can use them at home. But it's very easy to build. We have extremely detailed instructions. And we let folks sit down and start working on it. And we give them technical support where they need it. And they walk away with fully functioning antennas that they built themselves.
And I am smelling the sweet, sweet aroma of melting solder, I believe.
There's nothing like it.
So the real smoke and solder going on here.
Absolutely, yep.
And it's not just crimping and...
That's correct. And, you know, there's some measuring and some cutting going on as well. And, one of the things we do is we just sort of keep an eye on people to make sure they're being safe with the tools. But, you know, when you take a look at the table, you'll see there's all kinds of people sitting here. You know, men, women, young folks, old folks, all kinds of people get involved and build these antennas. And it's really a great way to share the fun of homebrewing radio equipment with a broad audience.
You get the impression that most of the folks that are here building this antenna, this is kind of like the first thing that they've ever built?
Quite possibly. I would say probably 50% of the people here, that is probably the case.
Are there any common things that you have to help them with? Get them over a hump?
No, the instructions are pretty detailed. You know, sometimes we're all human here. Sometimes we read things wrong, don't quite do things right. And so we try to help out in those situations. And, sometimes we can just make adjustments to get things like they were supposed to be. Or sometimes we have to redo pieces of it, but it's rare that somebody walks out of here with an incomplete antenna or something that doesn't work.
The roll-up J-pole is something you guys have built almost every year. Have you tried anything else?
We have. This is my 10th year doing the table, and in years past, we've offered second projects. We've always offered the J-pole as long as I've been doing it, but we've also offered second projects. We did some satellite Yagis for a couple of years. We've done code practice oscillators before. The past few years, we focused just on the J-poles. And the reason for that is our volunteer that runs the table has gone really, really deep on that and produced, he's We've done massive upgrades to the equipment, super detailed instructions, jigs, measuring templates, that kind of stuff. So rather than offering two projects and, you know, rather than a breadth first type offering, we're going with a depth first here to just guarantee the success of what is our most popular project.
So if somebody was to take this idea and run with it at their local Hamfest, this is the way you would recommend that they go?
Yeah, it's definitely, you know, it's most of the work that Alan has done is around eliminating errors and just helping people be successful, and that's what we're trying to do. You know, we want people to walk away with a working piece of equipment that will serve them well.
So it's been a trial and error thing for you guys who run the show as well.
Oh, definitely. You know, 10 years ago when I started, we just had little plastic tubs and some old Harbor Freight pliers and such, and you know, some really cheap soldering irons. You can see the ones we've got now, they're temperature controlled. We actually have junk soldering irons for burning off insulation. You know, and we have these units that Alan built to hold everything down, which also helps improve the safety of the table here.
You seem to have not only a lot of people coming by to build the J-poles to learn this stuff, but you got a lot of instructors.
Yeah. Yeah, every year.
Seems exciting for those guys, too.
Yeah, I enjoy it. You know, it's just something that I like seeing people. You know, my favorite visitors are the ones that are sort of squeamish, and they kind of look at it and say, oh, I can't do this. And I say, yes, you can.
We will not let you fail.
That's right. And that's, you know, it's really empowering for people, and that's what we like to do.
Do you get repeat customers from one year to another?
Occasionally. You know, it's... It takes 30, 45 minutes to build one, so most of the time people don't repeat, but sometimes they do. Often they'll bring friends, you know, or family members, and, you know, they may sort of hang around and help out their friend or family member, but that's probably more common than one person coming back just to build another one for themselves.
Do you get anybody coming back just to tell you their success story in ham radio?
We do, but normally something I try to do every night after the Hamfest is go check into the local nets, and I will hear these antennas in use.
I bet that feels good.
It does. It's great.
Thank you, Justin.
Thank you.
Okay. So that very well may be something that you want to do at a Hamfest. The Raleigh Hamfest guys try to put together a bunch of interesting things. They have some forums and those little activities. They had a youth station going on. In the past... And if you go back and look at the original program, Hamfest Fun, you're going to see that we did a lot of other interesting things that we don't do anymore. Let me see if I can find. Yeah, here was the youth booth with a Van de Graaff generator.
Powers the pulley, which powers the bout, and it's like a brush up there that generates the static electricity.
Okay, so it's like rubbing your feet with socks on them across the carpet, except you have amped it up a bit.
Pretty much.
All right. Did you build this?
I did not. I think this was...
Yeah, so they didn't do that this year, and the other thing that they haven't done in a long time, I'm going to look for down the timeline here. Yeah, there we go.
I think our speaker's over here. You might want to get your microphone.
It's the QLF contest.
Right. I will use my
QLF is now try sending with your left foot.
In on the left foot area, and this is harder than it looks. Okay, go ahead and pick up my
and
sound.
And even harder if you take your shoe off and have the agility of just a stockinged foot.
Yeah, that would hurt.
I'm afraid I may have a hole in the toe of my sock, so we'll see. Let's see what happens here.
Okay, carry on.
Yeah, okay, not bad. So we did a lot of interesting things that they don't do anymore, which is, you know, sort of too bad, but they still do a lot of cool stuff, including for more than 10 years, that project building area for new hams. So that is cool, and I have lost my notes here. We're up to part 3, and this will be also a quickie. Reddit spy.
I'm infiltrating a Reddit meetup. It's a Reddit meetup, right?
Yes, sir.
Who am I talking to?
This is Adam, WX4WNC, commonly known on Reddit as Archangel Wix, WX.
Why do people... Wait a minute. Hold this microphone.
Yes, sir. You got it.
I got my own. Oh, it's over here. It was copying the satellite. I got my own. Why do people do that? Why not just call signs or names or something?
Well, when I first started Reddit, I really didn't have a call sign that I enjoyed. I was originally KK4MJR, and it was just too bland for me. So when I applied for WX4WNC, it wasn't really, I mean, I didn't have it at the time, and I created a Reddit account. If I'd have had it coincide, that's probably what would have happened.
So WX4, that's
weather
for, you got a weather interest.
Yep, weather for Western North Carolina. I actually have a degree in meteorology from UNC Asheville.
Okay, so you are, do you live around here now?
No, but we're thinking about
Raleigh,
it.
Raleigh, so we're not Western North Carolina by a long shot.
Yeah, we're on the other side of the state, just yeah. FYI.
We have no idea how to describe where we are. We're not Eastern, we're not Central,
we're there.
We're in the Piedmont.
Coastal Piedmont.
Yeah. So this, hey, how many Reddit people are here?
I'm here.
Reddit people, get in front of the camera here for a second. Super cool. Unless you're in witness protection.
Yep.
So I wanted to show the Reddit people.
Reddit.
Well, you got one.
Yeah.
Reddit, come on.
Okay. So pass the mic around. Tell people who you are. Oh, your Reddit. Your Reddit. Yeah. not your real identity. Your Reddit identity.
Okay, I'm John Breyer, KG4AKV, and my Reddit identity is JB Strikes Again, and I'm into satellites, and I have a YouTube channel. Like Gary, my channel is Spacecoms. I show satellite operation, ISS reception, slow scan TV, that sort of thing.
You already know me, so I'm gonna pass on the mic.
How do you do? I'm Cyrus, AK4XE. I'm just a guy on Reddit, mostly lurking, but I've been into amateur radio since high school, and I'm now with my extra.
So you're Cyrus. It's nice.
Hey, Cyrus. Hey, Cyrus.
Dude, you have some of the most helpful posts I ever read.
Oh, thank you. Tell us who you are. They don't know. It's me online.
Oh, they already said us. I'm Archangel Wicks. I was the one who created the post.
Hey, I'm user 179. I came to watch John do his thing. I've seen him on YouTube, but nice to finally see him in person.
Okay. Wait, hold it. So you guys, what's the deal with ham radio and Reddit? Why?
This is where the younger people go to get more of the younger take on things. You know, a lot of times it's more friendly, I would say.
So how old are you guys?
I'm in my 40s.
So by ham radio standards, that's younger.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
I'm just younger than that. And I like it because I can view a variety of things. It's not just amateur radio. It's just all of your interests can come together and, you know, things pass through and you can mix up all what you want to see.
I'm in my late 20s, and the same reason him, because I love ham radio, I love building my own home lab. I'm a network engineer as well as a meteorologist, so I dabble into a lot of things, RF and technology, and Reddit allows me to ask those questions without feeling like somebody's going to look down on me. It's like, you should know this already. Oh, well, here, let me help you.
There's all kinds of people that don't know anything.
Right,
exactly.
Everybody wants to help everybody.
And that's why that community is so great, because if you go to our amateur radio or our home lab, you ask a question, within 30 minutes, you'll get a response.
Now, there is a little snark. Does that just go with the age? Does it go with being the internet?
I think it goes with being the internet, but you get snark everywhere. Yeah. I'll say people are more, like you said, you got a question, you want an answer, somebody will give it to you. You might get some snark, but somebody will come right behind them. Dude, why are you being so snarky? At least help the guy out.
Exactly. They're wanting to learn. They're not here to like test knowledge. They want to figure this out. So help them.
Okay. So now I'm 67 years old. What am I doing here? They have no idea. They don't know what I'm doing here.
Crossing the divide a little bit. We have different audiences.
I would say Reddit, it's obviously not for just young people. And there's lots of people that aren't, you know, below 40. There's people that are older. And they contribute, you know, their more Elmer knowledge, you might say.
Yeah. They can get on there now and then, like, when they dust the cobwebs off with their typewriter.
But, I mean, I know we make jokes because the older hams look differently or not so favorable on the other hands for many reasons. But the bottom line is Reddit doesn't care what age you are, what class you are.
Right.
They're there, like you said, to help anybody that needs help. So whether you are 26, 66, or somewhere in between, you're going to find a helpful crowd.
Did we get some more Reddit lurkers back here?
Yeah, we did.
Yep. I'm KE4VNC, otherwise known as Shish Kibos on the forums. Yeah, that's it. Not a huge poster, but I browse a lot. So.
All right, and?
KM4DVE, BZ Grim Reaper.
Okay, so this isn't a bad meetup. This is pretty good for a tiny little ham. Well, it's not a tiny ham fest, but it's not Dayton. It's not Orlando.
Yeah, can I just say, Archangel WX here, he created the thread about the Reddit meetup. I don't think
here, Raleigh.
They knew that on video.
Oh, well, yeah. I did because coming to Raleigh, I've been here for, I want to say, 4 years now. This is my favorite Hamfest in the state. And I was like, well, there's a lot of people in North Carolina. Let's give them a chance to meet up.
Yeah. Now, Reddit, of course, is huge. It's not just the ham radio stuff. Do you guys go everywhere else in Reddit or anywhere else in Reddit?
I'm mostly on amateur radio and maybe space and a few others.
Yeah, because it can be a scary place.
Yes.
You guys have been to the other places. You've been to the dark corners.
Just pick out the good stuff.
Yeah. Exactly. Filter out everything else.
And this is a worldwide platform, and Raleigh's there on the thing, you know.
Yeah, we got R Raleigh. I'm on R Raleigh, R Android. I'm going to shorten it up. I'm over in about 200 subreddits. Mm-hmm. I lurk through most of them, but I'm active in about 20 of them.
Do any of you guys actually talk on the air?
Yeah.
I talk on satellites. I actually check into the nets around here. I'm trying to be more active and not just an internet person.
You'll find me on PRN a lot, the DMR network out here, because where I'm from in the western part of the state, unless you have an HF radio, you can't get out here. So I use the digital network to extend my reach.
2 meter sideband. And one of the few people who use 2 meter sideband.
I was going to say, not a whole lot of that out there.
No, but it's fun. So.
All right.
I'll just say I mostly use ham radio. I don't post on Reddit as much.
All right. And how many people know about the subreddit Hamcasters?
Oh, I haven't heard of that.
I do because I post my own videos and I need to post it on that.
You found it right away.
I found it right away.
Yeah. Yeah, it's when I started. I started a Reddit. Yes, I'm 67 years old. I started a subreddit, which I then was told and learned is totally against the Reddit terms of service and procedures and policies and stuff, because it's self-promotion. And then a whole bunch of folks said, "No, keep on going until the Reddit gods kick you off. Keep on going." So.
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
it's always better to just try it out and tell somebody compliance.
Better to seek forgiveness than permission.
John's thrilled with it, so I imagine other people are too. So I'd keep doing it.
The idea is I'm trying to get everybody who does a show of some kind, an audio podcast, a video podcast, a YouTube show, to post their stuff, because you don't want to see that all in r.amateurradio, r.hamradio, because they would flood the place.
It makes a lot of sense. I think it's a great thing that you've done.
So there's 106 people subscribed to it right now. Let's get this up to 106,000.
With that said, I do post my videos on the main amateur radio subreddit, but I only do it, I release a video. For a while, I was doing it every week. Now it's like every month, but if it's once a week, nobody minds, I think. But if you're spamming the same video or the same podcast every day, no.
I got to get on there more often then. All right. I'm going to let you guys do a real meetup, and I'm going to turn off the camera so you can say what you really want to talk about. Okay. The camera's off now. All
right, those old guys suck, man.
That will be cut out.
There's Reddit. For those of you who have never been there, there is Reddit. You can see the stuff that's been posted. Reddit is a very antique-looking bulletin board-type website, deliberately. They don't try to look fancy and modern. And here's the Hamcasters. So if you haven't subscribed, if you are a Redditor, or if you're not and you want to go by Reddit and find Hamcasters, I haven't gotten a lot of people to... start announcing their stuff on Hamcasters. I've gone and looked at some of the other guys' shows, like this Ham Radio 360. Notice that I put this up here. I don't think those guys even know that Hamcasters exists. They might not even know that Reddit exists. This is sad. I had to announce a Phasing Line podcast. Marty, get on the ball. So Reddit's got, that amateur radio. And then there's also ham radio. There it is, way over there. And you can see some of the other things that I'm interested in if you look over up at the top. Nexus 6P, my phone. I'm a mod. I'm the mod for Hamcasters, so I get that. Rescue dogs, rescue cats, something else I'm, interested in. Dogs, not so much, but I'm thinking about a program. So anyway, That's the Reddit deal. And we're done. It's the end of the show. Pretty cool. HamRadioNow, as usual, say it with me. Brought to you by you. HamRadioNow.tv, find Arvin. Send me money. And that's it. I'll see you guys later. 73, over and out. Am I enticing you guys out there on Facebook Live to want to watch the show? It won't be on until tomorrow, because late tonight, I'm not going to edit it all tonight.